doesn't mention the Trinity. Doesn't mention the Trinity. The Trinity doctrine is that there's one God, and this one God consists of, or subsists of, three persons. The Father, who is fully God, the Son, who is fully God, and the Holy Spirit, who is fully God. He does not articulate that doctrine.
When they're within the first 200-300 years, Christians will believe in two gods.
Sure.
Justin Martyr talked about two powers in heaven. Justin Martyr, the mid-second century Christian philosopher, he talks about two powers in heaven.
Bert Ehrman, in his book about the early Christianities, he talks about various groups of people, the various Christianities. Your particular concept of God is one of those competing ones, so, which happened to then become sort of a overcoming and dominant.
It was enforced by law. Under Theodosius II, the Trinity idea was enforced by state law, and if you disagreed with it publicly, you were executed. That's why for over 1,000 years there was no dissent, because people feared for their lives. I'm not exaggerating, that is just a fact. That's the only reason the Trinity doctrine gained its universal and consistent consistency for a millennium, was because of the threat of death.
Actually, the deity of the Holy Spirit is affirmed in the New Testament by the New Testament authors, and is as
the early fathers didn't believe.
I said there were followers, there are people within the Christendom, within the first few centuries, who didn't believe exactly what you believe. Now, if I were to talk about their followers, they would say, look, why doesn't the Quran represent my view? In fact, what the Quran does, what Allah does, is actually he refutes every single branch of Christianity. Let's see how it does.
Ignatius of Antioch, another witness, Ignatius of Antioch, a very early father. We have about seven authentic letters of his, extant, Penguin Classics. Nowhere, when he talks about God, does he ever mention the doctrine of the Trinity.
Actually,
he never says...
Actually, he does.
Oh, really? Would you like to show me where?
For example, I'll pull up
Michelangelo. So let's return
the
to...
The doctrine of the Trinity, I'm taking about.
Yeah.
Okay, well, you need so to we can talk about
welcome
this.
Welcome across it.
The passage in Ignatius, I want to...
Please say. What does this do with anything? Yeah.
Okay. You've asked me about Ignatius. So you've got the...
If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. You've got
the hymn that he made, that he quotes from. There's only one position, very flesh and spiritual, created yet born, God and man and one he creates us, and like union. He affirms Christ is God there, and we have the Father as God, and then we have seven stones you are, yes, stones of the Father's temple, stones turned red from God's build, hoisted up with the dirt of Jesus Christ, and cross with the Holy Spirit for him.
Doesn't mention the Trinity. The Trinity doctrine is that there's one God, and this one God consists of, or subsists of, three persons. The Father, who is fully God, the Son, who is fully God, and the Holy Spirit, is fully God. He does not articulate that doctrine.
But it does articulate the deity of the Father and the Son, and distinguishes them. And it does mention the Holy Spirit in that sense.
I chose my word very carefully, because I'm aware of the debates. I said that Ignatius of Antioch does not teach the doctrine of the Trinity. That's precisely what I said. I did not say that you could collate together from here, and put together in a doctrine that you have constructed, that you then say is Ignatius' doctrine of the Trinity. That is a different exercise and a highly disputable one. I said he does not teach what Chalcedon teaches, what Nicaea 2 teaches, what Council of Constantinople 1 and 2 teach. Doesn't teach what any of the later church, because no one did in the early years. No one taught the doctrine of the Trinity in the early centuries.
I would argue that that's completely
Can you give me another example? Because Justin Martyr says there are two powers in heaven, not three. The two are Jesus and the Father, the Son and the Father. He does not say that God is three in one.
Does the Bible say that?
No, the Bible doesn't. I mean, it's a joke.
Does the Bible
it's a funny
say
thing.
That?
The Bible doesn't say that either. So we're arguing something that doesn't exist in the Bible.
I know
you don't agree, but this is the consensus of most scholars. It is well known. Overwhelmingly, scholars recognize that the Trinity is not in the Old Testament, it's not taught by Jesus, it was not taught by the earliest disciples, it was not taught by Paul. Paul says the head of Christ is God. There was a hierarchy, God, Jesus,
man, woman. Do you accept
man,
that Paul affirms the deity of Christ?
Sorry?
Do you accept that Paul affirms that Christ is fully deity?
About Paul believes in the
Trinity. It doesn't.
Yeah, but you did. But
the question is not about.
You've been right.
If the Trinity affirms propositions which together form the Trinity,
I think you misunderstand
Jesus never taught that. The key point here is ultimately a commonality here. You believe in Jesus, I believe in Jesus, you believe in Jesus. But the suggest that nowhere did Jesus ever teach that God is three in one.
It was your assertion that the doctrine of the Trinity was established at the Council of Nicaea in AD 325. Could you please respond to these statements made by Ignatius, Bishop of Antioch, in AD 107, which is 218 years before that? There is one physician of flesh and of spirit, generate and ingenerate, God in man, true life and death, both from Mary and from God, first passible and impassible, Jesus Christ our Lord, by the will of the Father and of Jesus Christ our God, for our God Jesus Christ, and finally, await the one who is above every season, the eternal, the invisible, the one who for our sake became visible, the untouched, the impassible, who for our sake suffered, who endured in every way for our sake. Could you please explain, if the doctrine of the Trinity didn't come about till 325, why Ignatius could say these words in AD 107?
Right? Exhorting obedience to Christ and to the Father and to the Spirit, right? But this idea of the Trinity doctrine, it came over time. Look at that, 110 after Christ. And nobody knew about it. It's amazing.
Why Ignatius could say these words in AD 107. Could you please respond to these statements made by Ignatius, Bishop of Antioch, in AD 107?
Ignatius is, we think, an early bishop. We don't really know much about him, except that there are some letters that purport to be from him. He's believed to have been martyred sometime between the year 98 and the year 117. So people have, for a very long time, been very interested in Ignatius because he's only, you know, one or two generations after the apostles. This is somebody who easily could have met the Apostle John, for instance. The problem is that it has long been very controversial which, if any, letters attributed to Ignatius are really by him. A whole bunch of them have come down to us in manuscripts. I would say that the conservative mainstream position, a position that many Protestant and Catholic scholars would go for nowadays, for instance, if you look in the edition called The Apostolic Fathers, edited by Michael Holmes, you'll see this position in the introduction to the letters of Ignatius. The mainstream conservative position is that exactly 7 of these letters are genuine. The problem is, even those 7 letters come in 3 versions, there's a long one, a medium one, and a short one. The mainstream position is that 7 of the letters in the medium length are genuine, or at least mostly so, maybe with some later corruptions. There is some scholarly consensus that the short version of the letters is just kind of an abridgment, a paraphrase that's been shortened down by somebody later on of the middle length letters. Because if you want to know what the original letters said, the short ones are just leaving too much out because they seem to be an abridgment of the middle length letters. What about the much longer version? Scholars are pretty much universally agreed, and I agree as well, that the long version of the letters of Ignatius are from the 4th century. That is, somebody in the 4th century who became known to history as one of the, quote, Arians, a person with that type of theology, took the middle-length letters and stuffed them full of a bunch of other stuff to push it in a, quote, Arian direction. Scholars across the board now agree that this is how we got the long version of the letters. It's just the medium-length ones larded up with a bunch of extra stuff, which is clearly from the 4th century. You would hope, then, that the middle-length letters would be the genuine ones. Well, I wish it was that simple. When I read the middle-length letters, and some scholars agree, but there's not really a consensus about this, when I read the middle-length letters, I see some things that sound like they're from the early 2nd century, which is when these are supposed to be from. But I also read things that sound like later monarchian theology. I see terminology and issues that really arose, particularly in the early 200s. So I think that even the middle-length letters have been heavily corrupted. I guess I think that there probably are some genuine parts there, but there's no way to really separate things out. Right, so we're talking about a difference here of perhaps 100 years, difference between something written around the year 100 and something written around the year 200, or maybe somewhat later than that. It's not that hard to discern these later elements. Imagine that you're reading something that's supposed to be a letter from a soldier who served in World War I, right, 1914 to 1918. In the middle of this letter, he mentions cybercrime. Well, hold on a second, Buster. Cybercrime? That term was invented in the 1990s. That just can't be right. If this is a genuine letter and not a complete forgery, then somebody has added in this part that mentions cybercrime in a letter from 1918. So it's harder when you get farther on in history than we are from 1918 and from the 90s, but still it can be done. And there are some scholars, a minority, who think that these letters were just wholly forged later on. I think there's probably a genuine core there. Okay, so this is the huge headache that's been caused by this, frankly, evil Christian habit of forging letters to try to support their theological position, which was just rampant in the ancient world. We need to read the footnotes. We need to read the introductions that scholars give us to these books, so that we can know when we're dealing with fakes or with genuine but heavily corrupted sources that we have to be very careful with. So let's stick to sources that are plausibly from the 2nd century. What about the 7 letters of Ignatius? Well, in those 7 letters, if they're genuine, and again, I guess I think that at least some of them are genuine, although I also think they've been corrupted at least once, probably in the late 100s or sometime in the 200s. Really, I think we have to be skeptical about those letters. They seem to pointedly call Jesus God and our God. Again, that's a later habit that just wasn't done around the turn of the second century. You do see it, of course, all over the third century and beyond. Here's a more interesting source. This is the letter called First Clement, which scholars date to perhaps around the year 95. And really, First Clement sounds very much like the New Testament in most ways. The creator there and the one God there is the Father. Jesus is repeatedly called his servant and is described as our high priest. The book of First Clement never says that Jesus is divine, never says that he has divine nature and human nature, and it never says that he existed before his conception. None of these Christological claims are either explicitly said or implied or suggested or even presupposed by anything that's in that book. Again, in this book, it's just God, that is the Father himself, who's the creator. In fact, that was always the emphasis in Christian literature until a certain point in Christian history. On then to another source. This one's called the Didache, and this was only discovered in the 1800s. It had been long lost, and it's probably from the late first century or the first half of the second century. The scholar Bart Ehrman says it's maybe between 100 and 120, although was probably based on earlier materials. It's a very interesting early Christian piece, which reflects a strong Jewish influence throughout. And the one God in the Didache is addressed as Holy Father, as Almighty Master, and as Our Father. And it's that one God, the Father, who is said to be the creator. And Jesus is repeatedly called his servant.
My basic case in my book, How Jesus Became God, and that I presented last night, is as follows. I don't think that Jesus himself called himself God during his public ministry. I personally don't think Jesus imagined he was God. He wasn't God. He was God's prophet.